the Oswegan Demons losing last night. A statistical four-way tie for first place to these two teams are part of it. The Southwest Cyclops, the Durham Turfdogs, they travel to the General Motors Center here in Oshawa, Ontario to stake their claim to what would be home floor advantage throughout the playoffs. Matthew Garrett, Steven Stamp to call this CLax action here on the JBI Sports Network. We welcome you inside the building today, and can't put it any other way. It's the battle for first place.
It is. After the result last night, of course, with Barry moving into a tie with their second win, so much on the line for these two teams. That's eerily quiet in here as they're doing the ceremonial face-off, but it won't be for long. Things will really crank up. These two teams very evenly match. As we take a look at our players to watch for Southwest, so much on the shoulders of, Tyler Burton. Travis Burton. I was wondering, Tyler Burton would be a huge addition to this lineup. He was probably their best player last year. But Travis Burton, no relation. I asked him at the combine. And he's a high draft pick for them, and he's really starting to find his way in this league. On the other side, for the Durham Turfdogs, we have Josh Lawson. I'll let you see his numbers while we go to the national anthem.
Starting goaltenders for this afternoon's game, we look at Jay Priest, the human highlight reel for the Southwest Cyclops. Don't blink when the offense comes down the floor. He's going to do something spectacular today.
And the two-time defending player, defensive player of the week in the league, he's really been on fire. Kevin Croswell at the other end, playing for Durham. And probably not quite a spectacular goaltender, but a very steady goalie for the Durham Turfdogs.
I don't think anyone's as spectacular a goalie as Jay Priest is. I called Angus Dineley and Jake Henhock the two most solid goaltenders in the league. But these two, definitely no slouches in their own right. We're underway. The opening faceoff bounces off the stick of a Cyclops player, then off the stick of one of the Turf Dogs. And it still ends up in a scrum over there on the sideboards. And referee Wayne Paddock with the call as he's joined by Mohammed Ershad and Gord Brown on the floor. Caden Pack will work the 30-second clock. Dan Keen into the corner. They went for Eric Petrie. They go up top. Now they come back for Matt Spanger. He's wearing 13 today. His 45 ripped hem to hem, Hulk Hogan style in his fight with Dumont. Spanger gets the loose ball again, then goes backwards over his shoulder. A nice save there by Croswell.
Spanger looks like a 13 anyway. He plays like a 13. I think it suits him. And just for
Nick Grasby disagrees, he looks like a 13. But
the scratches today, the notable ones, Blair Goss out for Southwest with a suspension, a one-game suspension after last game. And for Durham, Kyle Clancy still out, and Mark Farthing is on the injured reserve. He hurt his shoulder a couple weeks ago in a game we saw here in Durham. But Josh Wasson stepping it up. What a shot by Josh Wasson from the outside, just letting it rip and getting it by Jay Priest.
It's funny, I was between the benches on Sunday when they faced Barry, and he was the guy that said they wanted to start moving the ball around. This one's very late in the shot clock, maybe 1-0 seconds. And watch the room that he creates for himself just backing up. Looks like he's on his way to make a change. And a wide open net, and that bouncer just fools Priest to his left side.
Well, and a wide open look at the shot from Jay Priest. That's just a great shot by Josh Wasson. I still remember a few years ago at a Man Cup in Peterborough, Tyler Richards, the New Westminster goalie, saying, you know, who down on the floor before a game, as they drive towards the net, losing it, He was saying Josh Wasson may have had the hardest shot on that team.
That's saying something on that team. 1:09 DJ Nedelko brings it back for Southwest. He was staring down Jesse Guerin. So the Turf Dogs make a couple switches to kind of hide him down low there. Comes back for Mike Burke. Over to the far side. Nedelko walking out of the side. He gets a couple bumps. The ball was out of his reach, though. So it's back for the captain, Burke. Under five to the shot clock. Burke sidearms it just into the logo of Croswell. And it comes back for Guerin. 1-0 here in the building as Guerin up on the crease to shot. And that one goes over top of the net from Aaron Brown. They did reset the shot clock, so I guess Priest got a bit of it as Cody Adamson flips it back for Guerin. Kranz is going to chase him all the way up and over the center line to go over and back. We saw these mental mistakes last night at the game at the Iroquois Lacrosse Arena.
Yeah, and Southwest can want to try and pressure like that. That's what caused that mental error, but Durham trying to recover.
To try and get it into Dylan Webster on the crease, and he can't handle that, just running out of room. Didn't want to step on the line either. Causes a turnover anyways. Goddard, they're going to pressure him to try and get him over and back. He spins away nicely. Gets it into the corner. A bit of a give and go there with John St. John. And the return out of the reach of Dylan Goddard.
I think that pass may have actually been intended for Joe Wasson, who was a couple steps further over and probably had a bit better angle on that.
10 seconds. Nice job by Dylan Goddard applying the pressure there. And this timeline is going to come into play this afternoon. Already two calls. One a 10-second count, one an over and back. Here's Grasby diving through, and that foot was well into the crease. A great, good call by Gord Brown.
And just before that happened, a smart play. You see Michael Cudmore coming up, saw a double team coming to him at center and didn't step across the line before he was going to get trapped. He cut diagonally instead and was able to get across and get a pass off.
Good awareness of the clock as well, knowing he had time to put the brakes on. Saved by Croswell. Some fancy footwork here by Brandon Armstrong. You see swim moves around Petrie. And they've got men coming off the bench. The arm is up on the official, though, as Guerin shoots it off the glass. And then it comes back for Bergen. He was in the crease. And we've got a holding call coming against the Cyclops.
So Durham goes to the power play with a 1-0 lead. See how they can manage. They've had middling success on the power play. It's worked really well for them at times. They've really taken advantage of the short man, actually. They've scored a fair number of shorthanded goals.
They were built last year as a transition team, but they were built that way with Mark Farthing and Mac O'Brien.
Mm-hmm.
Two guys who aren't in the lineup, who haven't been in the lineup for the majority of the season this year. Over for Bergen, he just rips a shot in on Priest, who makes the save. Then he's got to drag it back, and we've got a loose ball collision there with Alex Lubchuk. They say that's too much, so Wasson gets it started with a fresh 30 up for Guerin. Down on the crease, Wasson looking for his second of the game. Priest comes up with the save. Guerin leading the league in assists with 10 in just three games. Here's Eric Petrie walking in on the crease, takes the shot before he got there. And it bounces back to him while he's still in the crease.
I guess he was hoping that nobody would notice.
Yeah. You're allowed to clear out and then make that play, but he was on his way clearing out, hadn't got that far yet. Here's Guerin over for Bergen. They pressure Guerin up top, and they go back down on the crease. The shot and the goal from Jeff McNulty.
McNulty really showing his touch last week. He started to really find his range. He's got 6 goals now on the season, and he's a guy who really brings a tremendous touch around the crease to Durham. You'll see on as he takes this shot. Here we go. Guerin down to Bergen. It's going to come across, and very quickly. Here, we'll get a look at it on this one.
Keep your eye on the bottom side of your screen. Yeah. This is where the quick stick's going to come
that
from.
That is so quick. And we've talked about how they used to love to do that with Scott DeFrancesco. Now McNulty stepping into that role and doing a really nice job of it there.
Huge battle here for the faceoff. That goal for McNulty. There was a logjam at 5 goals. Now there's a logjam at 6. The statistical tie for second place in CLax. Priest comes all the way to the restraining line, then bounces it back to his crease. And they got to hurry. They've only got 2 seconds to go over center. Spanger casually brings it over that line. Goddard and Grasby pick up the assists. As a collision there, Petrie and his man fall. Ball goes into the corner, 5 seconds on the shot clock here. Spanger looked at the far shot clock, actually, and then realized how much time there was and uncorked. Bit of a change up in on Croswell, didn't get as much as he wanted on it, and Priest comes out for a run again.
He goes even further this time.
He's going to score today. I'm calling it right now.
Except he's not allowed to go over center.
Well, whatever. It's going to be a long shot. Tyler Glebe will play backup role, as we saw Grant Crawley leave last week. Not sure if he's still nursing an injury or not, but Grant Crawley on the sidelines for this one. So maybe in the official's timeout, which we're about a minute away from here, goaltenders will talk to each other and reserve some of that energy. There's an outside shot from John St. John. Priest had thoughts about running that down, but with a man right there, he thought otherwise. Loopchuck gets it, had a breakaway taken away from him, and then turns into a two-on-one. Loopchuck keeps, scores.
Nice presence of mind by Loopchuck not to panic when he lost the ball, not to get deflated, because he had a clear-cut breakaway until the ball popped out of his stick as he tried to accept the pass. He just calmly picked it up, ran down, ran the two-on-one. You'll see he spreads out to his proper side, looks off Mike Burke, and just fires it over to the far side. And you have to pay a lot of attention to Burke if you're the opponents. Obviously, he's racing in. So
nice play by Lubchuk. Whether it's hockey, lacrosse, anything, make sure that pass doesn't get through.
Yeah.
Especially if it's Mike Burke.
Yeah.
This is still the battle for the faceoff. As it squirts out, it's in the stick of the Cyclops. And they're going to say the Cyclops had it first, and they call it over and back as it comes back over the line. John St. John across the width of the floor. Comes back for McNulty. John St. John again. St. John tried to go over the top. He had a pick and a nice slide over there by Jake Kranz as we've got an off-ball slash coming. And it's coming to the Cyclops. They go to their second man-down situation. And 0-for-1 on the penalty kill so far this afternoon.
Yeah, and a little frustration there for Joel Shepley. He's adjusting to this league, coming up from primarily a junior B career where he's a very, very successful transition player and joined the Six Nations Arrows for a Minto Cup run this summer, last summer.
He wasn't in the lineup on Saturday night as they were honored as part of that Minto Cup ceremony out in Wallaceburg where he played his junior B. Oh, McNulty. He's not going to miss that very often, and they've worked this play for years. Pretty much their entire run in this league, like you said, different personnel. And I think teams know the play's coming. There's just not much you can do when the ball moves around as much as it does beforehand.
Well, and Jay Priest is going to come out and talk to Eric Petrie. But Priest is up pretty high. DJ Nedelko gets chasing a little bit, watching the ball, heads over to his right. You can see him sliding across the crease right now. He's going to go hard for that other play. Not too bad, but Petrie was just up, well up above, and McNulty left all alone. And like you said, he had a wide open net to get that shot off. There goes the Durham mascot, Tucker, heading up into the crowd. And it's a pretty nice turnout here today. We've got a decent crowd on hand. Hopefully we'll get into this one as we go along. It's 3-1, so they should be pretty happy with the way things have started out. The Turf Dogs taking that early lead. There you see Jeremy Talivi trying to instill a few things in his team to get them turned back around. But certainly the way we've seen runs going back and forth in this league, nobody's going to worry too much about an early deficit.
An interesting coaching battle here this afternoon. Jeremy Talivi's been with the league since day one. The Peel Avengers moved to the Niagara Lock Monsters when they made the transition. And now, of course, with the Southwest Cyclops, the most experienced coach in CLax. Over to the other side, the least experienced coach in CLax, Matt Giles of the Durham Turfdogs.
Yeah, but Giles, of course, with a lot of experience elsewhere.
Of course.
There you see him right there, his playing career with the Peterborough Lakers and with 11 or 12 teams in the National Lacrosse League. Played a lot of lacrosse. He's coached for 5 years with the Peterborough Junior Lakers. Was named, he and his staff named the coaches of the year in junior, OLA Junior A a few years ago. So he certainly brings a good, solid acumen to the game. And whenever you talk to him, he's just such a calming presence around a lacrosse floor. He's he played that role as a player, and he plays that role as a coach as well.
Early movement there on the draw from Jake Kranz. Gives it to the Turf Dogs as they've got the momentum here early on outside of the official's timeout. John St. John off the wall to Grasby. Grasby around loop check. He's drilled there and then run over by Miller Rushbridge. He's going to bring the shot clock under 10 as they get it back, and it's 5 on the clock. It just goes over the shoulder off the backboards from Cody Adamson.
Yeah, one thing to notice, the Turf Dogs, when the two players collided, the one from each team there, there were two Turf Dogs racing after that loose ball. I'm sure Jeremy Levy's going to want his get his guys being a little more competitive going after the ball when it's on the floor.
Ball side to side. It ends up in the stick of the leading goal scorer in the league, Dan Keane. And it ends up in the pocket of the stick of Kevin Croswell. And out of everybody's reach, looked like Keane was about to run over a Turf Dog there. But the Cyclops get it back. Mike Burke on a breakaway, bounds around between the wickets of Croswell, ends up on the correct side. And play continues here for the Turf Dogs. Man, nifty little move there. Brandon Armstrong to get away from Nedelko as he came off the wall. Goes into the corner for Bergen. Bergen has Hogarth throwing a pick. Back for Goddard. Hogarth in the corner. He just misses the far side as Goddard tries to get the shot away. And Burton with a stick check on him. And Travis Burton is going to come down the near side of the floor.
Hogarth, known for his defensive skills, but we saw last week what he can do in the offensive zone with a couple of goals. And he actually let me know, I didn't realize, he played offense in his last couple of years of minors. He's primarily an offensive guy.
Oh, boy. As Rushbridge comes off the boards, a Turf Dog player just ran right over the pick and the stick came high. So the first penalty of the game coming to the Turf Dogs, and the Cyclops trailing by two here will get an opportunity to inch closer as Shewell goes to sit.
Yeah, Eric Shewell heading to the box. Like you said, he just went straight through the pick, and then it was actually after, right? Oh, there it is.
There.
When it comes up, he runs into him once, runs into him again, and just didn't like being stopped from where he was trying to go.
So the horn gets spread out here to start things off for the Cyclops. Burke, the quarterback man, now he goes to the middle to stir up trouble, and the shot over the screen of Burke, and Croswell not fooled by that. As a quick change here, Cody Adamson and Josh Wasson came streaking out the front door, and Adamson's going to take the shot. Priest goes down with it, and a nice save.
Nice little cut by Adamson to get through those two players shorthanded, but Jay Priest swallowed that one up. Good job not giving off any rebound as he just collapsed into himself to let the ball get suffocated in his chest.
I don't think he liked when I said he wasn't fundamentally sound a couple weeks ago, because ever since then, like you said, two-time defending defensive player of the week, and I won't say what's happening here because I've said that before and it's turned out bad for the goalie. Collision down in the corner as the Turf Dogs going after this. And they were about 4 seconds away from a 10-second count when the Cyclops player got too aggressive. And the ball does get out of the stick of the Cyclops player, does get over center, and wow, that's paying the price to score a goal as Travis Burton gets drilled on the power play, our player to watch.
Yeah, and you can see why. They like his size, his ranginess, and a combination of talent that he brings to the floor. He's just going to slide his way down and get off a nice quick shot. Looks even better in reverse, but he just hustles after that loose ball. Nice hard pass fake. And he's coming down on Aaron Brown, who is one of the better defenders in the league, and lays a pretty big hit on him, but he pays the price to get that goal.
Joe Wasson was looking for a breakaway one side. He had it Dylan Goddard streaking to the net, but he got filled in. That results in the Southwest opportunity there. The rebound all the way down to Southwest's restraining line. as Eric Petrie gets it back to the restraining line to our left. Dan Dean over to the far side. They return for Critch. He steps into a shot. That's off, I believe, Scott Gamble, who chases down the loose ball. Now Gamble has it. Circles the crease. Still being chased down here by Critch. And now he's going to pass off into the corner. Couple turf dogs all alone in front. There's the active stick from Priest as Cody Adamson gets robbed.
And Adamson. I was going to say Adamson, maybe one or two too many fakes there. As he could have released that pretty quickly, but seemed to give Priest time to get back into it as he waited on the top of the net there.
Thought Priest was
going to
put himself way out of position there looking for that ball, but no harm, no foul as it comes in, and a sidearm shot from Brady Hesseltine goes wide, so they go back up top for Burke. 10 on the clock. No, now they call reset. That must have hit Croswell. As Burke has it again. Burke switching places there with Hesseltine. Comes back up top, and this ball is going to cross center. As Kyle Childerhose went for the check instead of the ball, and that causes the turnover here for the Turf Dogs.
Yeah, not a bad play, though, to just go for that check and slow things down, because if he went for the ball and didn't get it, even if he picked the ball up, his momentum probably would have carried him over the line. That way he was able to at least not let Durham have a break.
Here's Wasson, a huge shot from the outside, that hard shot you were talking about, and now one of the Turf Dogs picks up the rebound. It's Hogarth, gets the rebound again. Oh, how many fakes was that before putting it underneath a Priest?
That is a goal of the year candidate from Hogarth with that effort. He gets absolutely flattened by Travis Burton, who just nails him with the hit. He gets flattened to the ground, gets back up, gets the ball, goes through four of them. Look at that. He gets buried, comes back up. The ball bounces down to him. He manages to scoop it up in traffic with a man on him. He makes that fake and tucks it past Brees. Just watch how beautiful this is.
Man all over him. Still manages to get a number of fakes off. Wow. And the Turf Dogs will control off the faceoff again if Grasby doesn't go over and back. He loses it in the stick of Travis Burton. Michael Cudmore chasing him down as he zigs and zags his way around the crease. Comes up for Joel Shepley. Shepley trying to thread the needle. Falls afterwards, and that creates a two-man breakout here for the Turf Dogs. Not any sense of urgency there for Cody Adamson.
Well, Nick Crasby was cutting across in front of him, looking to get over onto his right side. I'm not sure if he didn't realize that Adamson, also a righty, was over on his correct side already.
Here's Goddard. Scores.
How did that get in? We're going to have to watch this one again because the initial shot definitely goes off of Priest. And somehow just finds the back of the net.
My goodness, what a creative play by Goddard, though, coming around the crease, then diving through. And it'll be interesting to see the dive here, because you do have to dive around the goaltender. You can't dive straight through. This is going to be pretty.
He's got to get past the goal line extended, which he does. Oh, it didn't touch Priest at all. That is just a perfect placement. He got that one around Priest with the full extension and just tucked it up underneath the crossbar. That's a gorgeous shot by Dylan Goddard.
Goddard's having a good year.
You know, he had a good year last year, and he's just gotten even better here in his second season.
Keane tries his dive move, and here's Hogarth. Petrie runs him into the boards. And now Petrie all over Hogarth. The bench wants a holding call, but not sure there was much there. Goes to the far side up top. McNulty, St. John in the corner. They go Jesse Guerin. Far side for Bergen. Coming back for St. John again. The shot clock's going to run out, though, so he just dumps it into the corner.
Southwest taking their time to move the ball up the floor. Just under 40 seconds left here in the first quarter.
Nice job by Webster right there on the crease. One motion, turning, and gets the shot away. The save from Croswell. Another shot there coming from Hesseltine. And that one, Croswell turns away. 20 seconds to play with the pressure coming down in the corner. The Turf Dog bench will call their timeout here. 19.4 officially on the clock here.
And the big thing for Southwest, I think, to come out of this quarter, even if they were to drop down 6-2, but if it's 5-2, I think they've got to come out of it thinking, we're creating chances. We may only have two goals, but they are creating opportunities. They just have to finish them. Things tend to change in that regard. As long as you're creating the chances, they will start to drop at some point. And they've had lots of looks at the net. They've had guys getting open in the slot. Done a nice job of passing, nice awareness, recognition of the cutters. So they're certainly not lacking from a creation standpoint. I think it's just a matter of finishing. For Durham, they want to make sure they keep the pressure on, because so many times we've seen both of these teams have been involved in games where there's one team has got out ahead and just taking their foot off the gas a little bit. You got to just keep pushing.
Well, they were down big against Niagara last week, mm-hmm. and were able to storm all the way back, winning their home opener last week in Paris, Ontario. I'd love to be a fly on the wall of that bench. That looked like a healthy discussion between Brandon Armstrong and Matt Giles. Like you said, definitely a veteran coach. First year here, with only a couple games experience, but definitely knows what he's doing, as they'll wait for the clock to get down to 7 with Croswell on the bench. Bergen starts it off to Wasson. Back for Guerin. Wasson again, his sidearm shot off the backboard. St. John plays it and can't get the shot away before time expires. Priest had the save anyways. But it's a 3-goal lead for the Turf Dogs after one quarter of play. We'll be right back from the General Motors Center in Oshawa.
Academy of Learning College has identified the gap between education and the stressors of the working world. We develop customized programs for each student at an affordable cost. Students can choose from over 30 diploma and certificate programs offered at any of Academy of Learning College's 17 Ontario-based locations. Simply a better way to learn. Learn more at academyoflearning.com. Fire Monitoring of Canada is the leader in the fire alarm monitoring industry, specializing in the early notification of fire alarm signals to the fire department. Our experienced customer service staff will work closely with you to develop the best solution for your specific monitoring needs, and our CFAA certified technicians are qualified to perform your installation quickly and efficiently. Be sure to choose Fire Monitoring of Canada, because saving time saves lives. Visit us at fire-monitoring.com.
Teams will switch sides here for the most exciting quarters in the Canadian Lacrosse League, the second and third, and right away they come running to the Turf Dogs after winning the faceoff. That was Guerin shooting it off the shoulder of Jay Priest, and the Cyclops will go back the other way. Sidearm shot from Petrie, not off the ear hole of Pete Rennie, and he's in pain as he comes to the bench here. Bergen looks over Goddard, and that one bounces in on Jay Priest.
That's a nice catch by Dylan Goddard to get that ball. Managed to get a shot off. Not much of a shot, but a beautiful catch.
Lupchuk. Pass was high for Keane, who had to climb the ladder to get it. They go for Heseltine. Webster's behind the net. He's got a cutter in front, though. It is Heseltine. That ball all over the goal line, but does stay on the left side of it. And it remains a 5-2 lead for the Turf Dogs.
Kevin Croswell must be living the good life because he is getting some breaks today. Ball's bouncing off the post and back off of him and out of the way. And that one rolling halfway across the goal line, just staying on the outside.
Can you hear our director Alex Frazza watching the replay? And based on the reaction, it sounds like it was close. Armstrong to Grasby. See if the Turf Dogs can make it a two-goal swing here. As St. John takes the shot and Priest with the save. There's a huge collision just as the ball was touched up by McNulty.
Well, and McNulty sidestepped the worst of it, and so he didn't take the full brunt, but that could have been really big.
That ball's in, squeaking through past the far side. Miller Rushbridge in transition, and the legs come into play here in the second quarter.
Southwest, number 12 with the goal.
Yeah, Rushbridge added to the roster after the season had begun. And you're going to see how quickly he makes this play. A nice little pass, just looking very casual before making the pass there. And then it comes across, and Rushbridge just tucks it home. This is going to be the play before. And there's the ball rolling across.
Oh,
more than halfway across the goal line. It rolls the entire length of the goal line almost. After coming down off of Croswell, just staying outside the line.
And they try and keep their foot on the gas pedal with the Southwest Cyclops. As Kranz walking out of the corner, he's gonna cycle back now over for Ryan McGregor. McGregor had his first goal in his career last week. Tried to get it out for Shepley. Couldn't get the shot away and get it in behind Croswell, so it's picked up by Scott Gamble. And they almost take out Mohamed Urshot. His first floor action in the Canadian Lacrosse League after a couple years as a fourth official in the junior ranks. Here's Bergen, fakes the shot, a nice cut move. Walking in, takes the shot, and no one wants to lose ball. Bergen goes up and over Rushbridge, comes down on top of the ball before it's finally dug out by Southwest. They touch it enough. And Wayne Paddock did call for a reset. That's why there's no over and back against the Turf Dogs here. Diving through the crease, the shot and the goal. I'm not sure about that. It looked like that time the dive came in the direction of the goalie. That's what Priest is saying. Now Wayne Paddock, veteran official, former official of the year, is going to go talk to Gord Brown about this.
We'll see after the discussion. Certainly the ball gets in. Bergen diving across.
And the signal is no goal.
Yeah, and he goes toward the goalie. And Shepley gives him a bit of a push.
A little bit of help.
But he's heading towards him anyway. Good discussion. We had a goal come off the board last night as well at the ILA in a situation where where there was a dispute, a disagreement between the officials, and they talked and got it right. And that's the best way to go about it.
Gord Brown, the crew chief, tonight actually took control of the rule book this year. Kind of cleaning some things up, so a guy that's edited the rule book should know what's in it. And I think that's a good call. Oh, from way outside, Dan Key skips it off the carpet, but that's going to cause Kevin Croswell to go for a walk here, as that's one he knows he should.
Southwest 77 from 32.
Yeah, Croswell heads over into the corner with his helmet off and just looks up and thinks, yeah, I've really got to stop the ones from outside the restraining line. Actually, he's just inside by the time he does take it. Nobody anywhere near Keane, probably because he wasn't in what's generally a super dangerous shooting position.
So a goal taken off the board. Back the other way. That is a two-goal swing. And now instead of being 6-3, we're 5-4. Again, with momentum all over the side of the Cyclops. This is where they're most dangerous, as they've shown so far this season. As Heseltine's going to pull it out of the pile. The bench urging the draw team of the Cyclops to get off the floor. And then Leapchuck on the crease puts a toe in. It'll be Turf Dog ball. As they're late getting the defense off, and it actually caused an extra man to get out there. Actually, they want that 10 seconds. Sorry, Zashaga was 18. And then Croswell shot that over center. And that time, the man came out early, and that's what that official is there for, to catch those plays. And it was close, but it was a penalty.
Seven.
Very unusual
seven.
To see the extra player coming out, the player coming out early, when it's in the offensive zone like that, and the play's already kind of underway, a little bit odd. Usually it's obviously in a break situation where you're either trying to get that little edge to cut towards the net for a scoring chance, or defensively you're trying to take away a scoring chance on a break. So a bit of an odd one there.
If you're still used to the summer rules, of course, substitution penalties, substitution calls, penalties on offense and defense. Of course, when we switch back to the summer, that would just be a possession call. If you're confused about that, nice job on the errant pass here, picked off by the Turf Dogs. They're going to go for a run. Looks like Goddard bouncing it over to Hogarth. And over and back as it comes out beside the restraining line. As the Turf Dogs killing the penalty here. That's another rule change from OLA ball here in CLax. As Critch over for Keane again. So dangerous is Dan Keane, as he's been on fire since late in the second quarter of last week's game. Right about this time when he scored his first one last week too.
And he was had the stick wound up ready to go. Aaron Brown has to get over the line, just tosses it errantly, and here come the Cyclops 4-on-1.
That's never good, especially when Burke and Keane are two of those three. The fourth man stuck back was Eric Petrie, but it's not going to matter, as it will be Keane that puts it behind Croswell.
Yeah, smart play
Southwest
by Petrie.
Southwest 77-16.
Once again, Keane taking the pass from Burke this time. Croswell asks his wolf will head over into the corner for a stroll, but you can see Burke just waits and waits until he draws the defender, makes the pass over, and Dan Keane is a very good finisher and has Croswell at his mercy. Pretty nice shot by the other Southwest player. Just get out of the way and let Keane get that shot off.
That was Brady Hessel time.
Yeah, without cutting into the crease.
Brandon Armstrong now.
Everybody get
hopefully this will stop some of that momentum as Durham wins the faceoff, and they can at least get an extended pressure in 30 seconds without having Croswell face a shot.
14.
Durham does get one away as Brees makes the save. Comes up for Rushbridge. And Webster, his shot created a bit of a nervous moment there in the crease for Croswell before he did pick up. Gives for Pete Rennie. Pete Rennie tries to get it through John St. John, and Spanger crashes into his man behind the play, but did come back, and Brees tries to make a save. Jordan Critch. Webster cutting through the middle. No one goes with him. And Armstrong trips on a seam in the carpet for the Southwest Cyclops. Break the 10 count. Nice move by Critch to get around Wasson. Then he collides with Wasson. And 10 seconds. I thought the Cyclops had touched up, but no reset was signaled. So deep in the Turf Dog zone, Cyclops get a fresh 30. And their own version of the Turf Dog quick stick play.
You better have this.
As Burke
that's like four guys
down to Webster.
What a quick
Southwest pass. Southwest 25-16, 32.
That should be 11-16.
That's
there
what I said.
You can hear the official. Mohamed Urshaw, as you mentioned.
25-16.
The scorer doing a nice job to correct him. As he claimed it was from 25 scoring. Obviously Dylan Webster, number 11. Doing his best Jeff McNulty impression. Just passes the ball up top, steps in, perfect timing. And that was a perfect pass when you see how close the ball came to hitting a Turf Dog stick. It had to be a needle threaded. That's why a player's able to be open like that, because it takes an ideal pass to get there.
We missed it live, but a beautiful face-off win by Cudmore. Just ruck up out of the way and then draw it back between the legs. As we've got a moving pick down low, Andy Camber took his man into the boards about 20 seconds ago. They continue to jog. and Wayne Paddock sends the ball back the other way. Shepley shovels off to Mike Burke. As Burke over the top, and that one close to the face mask of Croswell. And they reset the shot clock. It must have hit him. As this one comes in, and Burke just walks in off the restraining line and shoots it over the shoulder of Croswell.
In full stride, gets the shot off. Not easy to
16-48.
Do. Accuracy and power, but he does it perfectly. Burke, who's really been more of a setup man in a lot of ways for Southwest so far this season, shows how dangerous a shooter he can be as well, as he just, again, at full speed, picks a corner. This will be a good angle to see exactly how the ball just sneaks its way over that left shoulder.
Here's the face-off by Cudmore. He's not going to do it again, but there's the win right there. And we're using more of field rules for the face-offs here at CLax, where you can do pretty much whatever without interfering with the ball.
Dan Keene off the post with the behind-the-back shot, but here they come the other way. Gamble is going to come in and stopped by Priest, and all the momentum just swinging for Southwest.
They've got Critch back the other way, and now Turf Dogs finally realize it and catch up. Here's Spanger. Straight down the middle, off the pipe. Bounces back to Gamble. Hogarth and Heseltine collide at mid-floor. Now it's a two-on-one back the other way. Hogarth and Aaron Brown. Brown gets it, and that's off Priest as he goes to his left. Now he's caught up behind his net. There's Brown back there to pick it up. And they'll settle things down here with Hogarth at the restraining line. Awaiting the official's timeout. There's a stoppage that should do it. And they do take the official's timeout. And we'll take our own timeout as the Cyclops, with all of the momentum here in the second quarter, reminiscent of last week, 7-5. Back inside the General Motors Center, Matthew Carrick, Steven Stamp, CLax action on the JBI Sports Network. Outside the official's timeout, the Cyclops get the ball. It's immediately worked the far side for Heseltine. That goes off someone's helmet, maybe Mike Burke. And I don't know if Burke had words or he wouldn't get away from the Turf Dog player. This will either be unsportsmanlike, which it is, or I was kind of wondering about delay of game, but Wayne Paddock heard something he didn't approve of, and Mike Burke will sit.
And it was immediate. It was one of those ones where Burke obviously said some magic word, because Paddock immediately took him off the floor after the moving pick call. Tell you, Aaron Brown, who was wide open last time I had a look, I think has had more open looks in this league without scoring a goal than anybody this season. He is snake bit so far.
What a move there by Wasson to get under the stick check and still get the shot away, as Priest makes the save, but it's a reset. And Guerin with a shot, that'll be another 30 if they can get over in time, and Bergen does. So an extended possession here, as Bergen gets it up for Guerin. He goes behind his back to the far side, McNulty. Goddard, Wasson, Guerin up top. Ball moving in all kinds of zigzag patterns, and that's the way they've all come so far this afternoon. Guerin to Bergen. ending up on the stick of McNulty, and that finds the mesh.
And that is McNulty's third goal, all from about the exact same spot, just at opposite ends of the floor. The first one was just a tennis racket bat in. The second one, he knew he had the time, so he caught it and made the shot. This one, you're going to see he's actually going to take the pass and drop his stick down low to tuck it into the net. There he is, just on the right of the screen.
Toes are close.
Very close, very quick release again by McNulty, and he has a hat trick. He is so dangerous down on that crease.
No one wants this faceoff. As Southwest gets it, that one goes over center, but the Turf Dogs are closest, so no over and back. It's going to be Armstrong. Rolling the ball off the carpet was John St. John. And Adamson's going to get it back, though.
Nice work by Scott Gamble to create some space for Adamson to pick that ball up. He does so many little things for a team.
John St. John pick and roll now with Guerin as he goes to the net. Shot, but running through the crease with St. John to play that one. So Priest will start off, and we'll see if the Cyclops can answer here. Down pretty big early on. They've clawed their way all the way back, have the Cyclops. That's kind of been their MO so far this season. Not a good way to play, but it keeps getting your wins. Round the crease, there's Burke trying to atone for his sin. Earlier, the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty as Petrie gets the rebound off the Burke shot. Here's Mike Burke calling for it. Guerin right in his face. I've been impressed with Guerin's defensive play.
Oh, he's been playing well defensively right from the start of his CLax career this season. Took him a while to get used to the running up and down and get used to the wind, Matt Giles said, but he's been very good at knowing what to do.
Mike Burke was on his way to the bench, realized that would have given Goddard a breakaway here. So Burke, normally an offensive guy and now winded as well, as he's really huffing down there. It's Petrie. Tries to cover the hole that he's kind of created. Still manages to slide over and knock the ball free, though, out of the stick of John St. John. That's a moving pick. No kidding. I don't even know why
the boards arguing. Were moving on that one.
And a break for Mike Burke as he gets the rest that he wanted earlier. But I guess missing the break of the Cyclops is he'll miss this offensive possession. It's off the back glass. Heads up, Alex, as it goes up into our director's position, and the race is on. Here's Adamson at the restraining line. Gets away from Andy Campbell, rather. And then drilled, looked like from behind. He gets up and finds the first thing in red he can and gives them a whack. All of that goes undisciplined as Childerhost gets it up to the restraining line. Andy Campbell. Lubchuk. And we've got another moving pick in front. That was Miller Rushbridge on Aaron Brown. And again, they have a discussion about it. And here's Grasby in tight. The Cyclops moved early, it looks like, as a delayed penalty coming here. And as they touch up, it will be a substitution call. And insult to injury, the moving pick they didn't like, and substitution call they don't like. They're having words here. This is after the play's gone, Petrie drills his man into the turnbuckle there.
That was a nice hustle play by Joel Shepley to get back and limit the options that Nick Grasby had on that break as he raced in, so they didn't score, negating the penalty before it even started. Now the Turf Dogs will go to the power play.
Travis Burton was on his way over, but it's got to be the in-home player, which today is Ryan McGregor for the Cyclops. Looking to tie here are the Turf Dogs. And already we've got a delayed penalty against the Cyclops, and the Turf Dogs do indeed tie it up, but we're going to have another player come to the box here, Alex Lupchuk, for a slash.
And Jesse Guerin just dialed in on that shot. We saw him last week in Barrie with a couple of beautiful outside goals, one to either corner of the net. tonight here this afternoon. He's just going to take this ball. Nobody steps out to him. So he'll just get that big overhand shot into the top corner past the stick of Jay Priest. And it is 7-7, just like that. We have ourselves a tie lacrosse game.
And Priest had words with Eric Petrie a couple goals ago. And Petrie, you could see there, he looks skyward as he believes he may have thrown a bit of a screen on that play. And how about Cudmore wins another draw back to Joe Wasson.
And, of course, Durham straight back to the power play. The first penalty that was in effect already is released. They get the full 2 minutes with the man advantage for the slashing call.
So they set up, keep your eye over on the far side. The Cyclops are doing that. Looking at Jeff McNulty, he's going to run around, chase the rebound, though. 5 seconds on the clock. Bergen, nice nifty move to deke out two defenders and then takes the shot. The rebound picked up by the Turf Dogs, though. It comes back for Bergen. Wasson again. Cyclops really doing a nice job now. You can see the box shifted over to the far side, especially down low as they try and take away that quick stick play. But that opens up that play right there as Josh Wasson shoots it over Priest. You got to pick your poison with this Turf Dog power play.
Exactly. You take that low pass away for the quick stick. As you mentioned, it's gonna open up space in the middle of the floor, and that's where Wasson takes advantage of it. Guerin, with the last goal on the power play, was able to bury one. He almost put another one in earlier in this possession, in the previous possession, but Josh Wasson will just step in, gets Priest moving to his right as the ball goes back to Priest's left. A great deceptive shot by Josh Wasson. We talked about how he shoots hard. He can also be deceptive, and he gives Durham the lead back.
A win for the draw team of the Cyclops. 93 seconds to be exact, for them to tie up. Going to halftime is Burton. He gets filled in by Gamble after he takes that shot. The save was made by Croswell. And the Turf Dogs have already used their timeout, remember, so they won't have one here going to break. The Cyclops is still in play. As they pick up now, a minute 14, they're just outside the zone where they would call it, as Keen gets the ball off the bench. Back for Ryan McGregor, fresh out of the box. As they go for Keane. Number of power play goals in this opening half for the Turf Dogs. That'll be part of the conversation in the room as Burt shoots over Gamble. Croswell to save again. He's waiting for the man out the front door, and it was Goddard. Nice job by Keane to tie him up and now go after the loose ball. Keane, Goddard, and Guerin in for that loose ball battle. Three of the big stars, emerging stars in the Canadian Lacrosse League.
And Keane, an important play to get in position and get that one, because Goddard had the chance to pass to Guerin or take that shot. All kinds of chances for them.
Keane intercepts the pass. I believe that was looking for Heseltine as he was cutting through. And Keane intercepted. It comes back for Critch. Southwest would now be inside their window, but they've got 10 on the shot clock as Critch has it. He goes around Hogarth. A number of fake moves before the corkscrew shot. Croswell with the save. 8 for the Turf Dogs to do something. They'll get a breakaway. Guerin in tight, and it's just over top of the net. And this ball is going to end up on the carpet as time will expire. St. John and Jake Kranz collide. But it will send us to the rooms with a 1-goal lead for the Durham Turf Dogs in the battle for first place.
And a pretty big comeback for the Turf Dogs to get the last 3 goals of the half after they'd had the 5-2 lead, then fall behind 7-6, really getting outscored, outplayed, out-hustled, out-chanced by Southwest to turn things around and get some energy back. Really helps going into halftime to get them ready to come out in the second half here at home.
So some interesting conversations will come up in both of these rooms. We will take a quick timeout. We'll leave you with images from here inside the General Motors Center in Oshawa, Ontario. Jennifer's Jazz It Up Dance Studio will be the halftime show.
Players, come play like a pro with Junior CLax. Want to play winter box lacrosse in the same great venues as the pros? Well, here's your chance. CLax operates a winter box lacrosse league for kids. Divisions range from U9 to the Prospect Division, or U18. Teams are located in Barrie, Oshawa, Niagara, Six Nations, and Paris, with games being played on the same days as the pros. Be sure you get yourself registered today, as the season starts January 2015. For more information, please visit CanadianLacrosse.com and come play like a pro. St. William's Nursery is Ontario's largest native plant nursery and is committed to biodiversity conservation. We offer a large selection of high-quality trees, shrubs, grasses, wildflower, and seed, all which are grown from a source-identified wild-collected seed. Visit us on May 2nd and 3rd at our annual spring public sale. Choose from a beautiful selection of species, all at special wholesale pricing. Visit us at stwilliamsnursery.com for details.
Nobody told me that, like, I don't own it, but, like, I take care of it. Nobody told me that, like, 6 hours to be here, so might as well get it going.
Bernier's
sick.
I just put Dion Phaneuf on the injury reserve.
Did they actually?
Yeah.
Did you say
if you read it? It's right in Nashville. Yeah, last day. And that was not worth it at all.
For a seventh, a conditional seventh.
Conditional.
Yeah. It's all, like, Phaneuf probably isn't.
Take that, Katy Perry. Jennifer's Jazz It Up dance studio at halftime, and now the big boys back on the floor. 8-7 in favor of the Durham Turf Dogs after that first half. Reminder throughout the game, let us know who you think the three stars are. Tweet us at JVI Video, use the hashtag three stars. And a number of candidates from both sides in that opening half. Matthew Carrick, Steven Stamp, our JVI Sports Network crew, bringing you Canadian Lacrosse League action all season long. Opening shot of the half goes to the Turf Dogs. Rebound picked up by Joe Wasson. As they bring it inside the restraining line. And the Turf Dogs content to slow things down here. Joe's brother Josh takes his place on the floor. Gives the ball to Aaron Brown. Looks like a bit of a tug on the shoulder. No holding call upcoming. As the Cyclops get it, Dylan Webster. Over for Heseltine, his shot in on Croswell. He's got his second save of the quarter out of the way.
Mike Burke doing a nice job there after getting away with the tug down at the other end to just go and create some space for Heseltine coming in after him on that break. So he had lots of room to get the shot off.
Here's Goddard taking the shot. That one's off of Priest. And then Priest has to check the bucket here. So looks like that one hit him high.
They're going to make some changes. One thing we missed in the first half was on one of Dan Keene's goals. And I saw him do something with his hands, but we're behind him. Couldn't quite see it. Somebody at the end asked what we thought about his Superman gesture. He did the cape opening or the uniform, the suit opening.
No, it was his Matt Spanger gesture.
His Matt Spanger gesture. Very well played, sir.
Yeah, I'll take it. Here comes Eric Petrie down the near side. Sends it over to the far boards. Just as Rushbridge is taking the shot with a moving pick in front.
I have to keep an eye on the benches with the exchanges as both teams were complaining to the officials about them being called and the other team not being called on guys leaving the bench early. They're looking for consistency. I think the officials think they're doing it because they're calling both, but both teams probably want a bit more the other way.
And again, Dylan Goddard playing a great all-around game. Throws a couple picks there to open some space. We talked about him earlier for his defensive prowess, and now what he does off the ball. That's the things that get guys noticed by the NLL and allow them to stick with their teams here in CLax. Over the shoulder from Critch. I think the best example of that, you guys were talking about Chris Atwood last night, looking away from doing all the scoring and maybe a little too much as he came back to the Demons last night. Off the bench is Goddard looking pass again and then diving through. McNulty, does he have four on the game?
Yes, he does.
Oh, buddy.
And what a play by Dylan Goddard. streaking down the slot. I was
at
just
71-49.
He's going to shoot at that point. He's jumping down. Look how wide open he is when he takes this pass. Hopefully they'll add an assist there to the righty who made that initial pass. But he was coming down. He did wind up taking the hit because he hesitated for a second to draw Miller Rusbridge out to him. And then he gets the pass over to a cutting Jeff McNulty. And McNulty, a beautiful play to finish it off. And there's Cudmore with the rugby-style scrum face-off win again.
We do give away Rookie of the Year. Can we give away a Sophomore of the Year?
I do not think we do.
Can we, though?
Would definitely be a leading candidate for that. Here in the standings,
the importance of this game.
Four teams with two wins apiece. Of course, Barry with a second loss already. But one of these teams will move into first place alone. And it will be the midway point of the season. One more game, and it'll be the midway point for the whole league. But these two teams will hit their midway point today. So, you know, as much as it feels early in the season with an eight-game schedule, it's late already.
We start to look at things like home floor advantage through the playoffs. That's what the Turf Dogs want to do. Crowd's been really good today, nice and loud, and great atmosphere here in the General Motors Center. Of course, they packed the place in Paris last week, so both of these teams want to be hosting that home floor game.
In Paris,
as do the Oswego Demons and the Barry Blizzard.
In Paris, they have a bit more of an advantage, I think, in terms of just having a different type of floor. I'm not sure that it necessarily, the smaller rink, suits their run-and-gun type of game, but they certainly have a different rink that they're more used to than anybody else with the smaller floor size for the Southwest Cyclops.
We were talking about it was a different floor last week. One of the junior officials threw the ball up at center for the face-off, and it didn't bounce. It just sat there. And so different, again, that's probably the most dramatic thing about having the home floor, as well as that's where Southwest does their practicing as well. Critch, on his way to the bench, just sauntered as he got close to the box. And consistency, and they want it called both ways. This first one's going to go to the Cyclops. Illegal substitution.
Ryan McGregor, the in-home, makes his way to the box. Jeremy Talevi just stood with his arms crossed, looking appalled by the call. But certainly the Cyclops don't like it, but Durham will get a chance here now with the 4-on-4 for the next 53 seconds, and then, barring more penalties, Durham will go up on the man advantage.
It's the second illegal substitution we've seen on the offense in this game. Here's Wasson, a pick and roll with his brother, and in the crease they call Joe.
Beautiful move, beautiful finish, just a little bit too far with the feet.
Here's Eric Petrie outside the restraining line. It is 4-on-4. Sorry.
It is. I didn't just make that up.
It's hard to hear anything in this building.
A lot of loud music.
Hear you say that. Well, we get the double because we're under a speaker, and then through our headsets we get it as well. But here's Goddard streaking through. A nice job by Priest. I think he goes side to side better than any goaltender in this league, and that's why he comes up with the spectacular saves. That one looks elementary compared to what we're used to him doing. Brown out of the box turns it into a 2-on-0 with Nick Grasby, who came off the player's bench. Brown tried to flip his stick over. I believe he had that in the wrong side of the stick.
It looked like a pass that he left for Travis Burton, his opponent.
Of course, the faceoff guys are used to doing that all the time. Aaron Brown, not so much. So it becomes a 42-second penalty kill for the Cyclops. They get that shot and a save by Croswell. Makes it 38 seconds in the power play. Croswell wasn't sure the call was. I would think you knew you made that save.
He may not have realized it got up into the meshes. It was only a couple of feet above the glass.
Okay. Huge collision down in the boards in behind Croswell. And Webster can't hang on, so it falls to Aaron Brown again. This time it's in the correct pocket of the stick. Pete Rennie back on the floor after taking that shot off the ear hole earlier, and he's going to get a goal for his efforts.
Nice play all around. It all started down in the defensive zone when Jesse Guerin got in the way of Dan Keene. Just a little bit of interference, a little bit of a pick to allow Aaron Brown to get that to that ball first.
23 from 9.
And Aaron Brown very, and I hope Aaron Brown's going to get an assist on that. We'll go tell them the number 4 deserves an assist as they didn't call it out because he really starts it off well. Just makes this nice little pass across to get Guerin and Rennie in there 2-on-1. That was the earlier crease call on Joe Wasson. I was still looking. I was expecting the goal.
I was like, I'm pretty sure that goal was good. But I guess that makes a little bit more sense.
I was wondering how somebody other than Aaron Brown managed to have the ball along the boards there. But sorry about that, folks. Our bad, not
well, they called out Guerin on the assist. I'm like, no, that's Josh Wasson. I don't know what's happening here.
And we shouldn't take away because of the confusion, but Pete Rennie with a beautiful little finish. Great three-man game with Brown passing the ball over to Guerin, who made the pass perfectly to Rennie, and he just tucked it home, showing that so many of these defenders, when they get a chance, can show some offensive acumen as well.
Cyclops looking for their opening goal of the half, and the dive in the direction of the goaltender. That one, we saw one taken off the board earlier against the Turf Dogs, so they're going to call that one against the Cyclops this time. As here's Guerin, puts the brakes on. Oh, my goodness.
Jesse Guerin. Oh, no, it's not going to count.
And they take it off the board again. Everyone had slowed down, and here come the Cyclops on the quick restart. Kranz shoots it wide. We're going to have to get another
look. And Matt Giles is furious.
Oh,
I think partly because they called the goal off, and partly because they started play again while the Turf Dogs were still celebrating and making their way to the bench.
And the other side of that, they've got their draw team on the floor. It's not their defensive guys. There are defensive guys in the draw team, but I understand his frustration, and he's still
letting him have it.
Paddock, this is going to be close to an unsportsmanlike here if he keeps this up.
I'd like to see the play again. I'm sure Alex Frazo, our director, will cue it up when we get a chance. We'll see whether it originally went in. Wayne Paddock definitely threw his hands up in the air.
But then he said, no, my bad.
Yeah.
But it looked like he pointed to the crease. I'm not sure if he's awarding goalie ball or he said it was in the crease. But an interesting play that takes one off the board, and there it goes back the other way. Stepping into it there, I believe that was
Spanger. That is Matt Spanger with the new number.
13 from 11. That red light on, but I was told not to do it after a goal.
Yeah, that's correct.
I was told not to do a TV timeout after a goal.
Yes.
They did take the first timeout after a goal in the first quarter, but that is correct in the rule book, not to take the official's timeout.
Exactly. We're going to take another look at this Matt Spanger goal, I believe. We're going to look down at the other end first. So here's Guerin, a little pivot behind the back, and unfortunately that's in the back of the net. That's not in the crease.
On the back, not in the back.
Yeah, on the back. And then we're going to see the goal here from Spanger. Nice little pass.
Matt Giles is still screaming on that bench. Looks like the anger is now directed towards his coaching staff and his players as opposed to the refs. But
huge turnaround as the one looked like it was in for Durham. Hands went up. Would have made it 11-7, and instead it comes down the other end in a 10-8 goal. And it's a big swing.
Lubchuk thought he had himself a breakaway, but that shot into his stick actually popped it out of his hands. So he kind of looked up and didn't realize what was going on. Bergen has that one popped out of his stick and then over the shoulder from Adamson.
Well, it had some help, a big hit. We are going to have the official's timeout now, and that was a big hit on Adamson, or on Bergen, knocking that ball loose. It is 10-8 as we go to the official's timeout here in the third quarter. I'm wondering, for one thing, if this could be the game where somebody finally breaks 14 goals this season in CLax. We regularly saw 17 and 18 goal games a couple years ago. This year, the defenses and the reverse transition really stepping up and limiting the opportunities.
I think finally we've got enough veteran guys who have played defense for a couple years. They've got that figured out, and that you get the new guys inserted into the lineup. I think they're passing it on. We've got veteran coaches all over the place. Not the entire staff of the Turf Dogs has turned over. It's just Matt Giles, who, of course, understands that side of the game as well, like we said. But they're getting used to this transition style, and I think that's part of the reason. As we show you our 3 stars information, at JBI Video, #3stars.
Let us know who you think they should be, and certainly some of the leading contenders. Mike Burke with a goal and 3 assists for Southwest doing a lot of other things very well, having another strong game. On the other side, Jeff McDonald with 4 goals, Jesse Geeran with 1 goal, 3 assists, and 1 almost goal. That was a beauty. And again, we didn't get a chance because of the controversy to talk about what a nice little play it was. Whoa. As he stepped down, spun back, and as he's spinning into the slot, goes behind the back to get the shot off. Just a tremendously creative play that somehow wound up in behind the net on the mesh.
And a high stick coming here. Kyle Childerhos in front, went in on Joe Wasson, and I thought initially it was gonna be a moving pick. And now they're gonna call it a cross check as it slid up into the face mask.
Childerhos demonstrating to Gord Brown as he heads to the box why it wasn't a penalty. Gord Brown, as you said, he edited the rule book, so he feels fairly confident that he knows what is and what is not a penalty.
Well,
him
and Wayne Paddock, I think, did it together, as Gord Brown's the head official for the junior game, but it was Wayne Paddock really that did most of that legwork. So the two of them controlling things down on the floor. So here's Tim Bergen in front for Jesse Geeran. Rolls away from him, so Geeran, the answer to the in-house trivia question, the leading scorer of the Turf Dogs, has to chase it down. It will go over and back, but nice job by Geeran there to flip it back over center.
Yeah, all in one movement, so it's definitely not a delay of game penalty, but Geeran almost got that one. Here's Travis Burton, who he's one of the standout rookies in the league this year as he tries to kill this penalty. Bear in mind, he still has 3 years of junior left. He's only 18 years old, turned 18
what?
On January the 1st.
That's a big 18-year-old.
Yeah.
With tons of skill. Look at him here. Beats 3 guys around the corner. Takes the shot.
You can see why they're so high on him and what he might become over the next few seasons. Oh,
I didn't know that. That's impressive. Couple sub 20-year-olds in the league this year.
Mm-hmm.
Couple on the Niagara Lock Monsters. Of course, they did that last year with Ty Carvalho and a couple guys as well. The Lock Monsters did. Man, I didn't know that. Wow.
Yeah.
Back to the task at hand, though, as McNulty looking for 5. Geeran gives it back to him. Sidearm just misses the side of the net. It was open off the backboards, and that'll go over and back over the timeline. Croswell, they're asking him to put it down. As both teams make changes.
And the Turf Dogs really racing to get their offensive guys off the floor there, as they'd had a long shift, so they could get the defensive guys out and they get the ball back. Not even just defensive guys, but just get a different shift out.
And I think they've, like you said, been talking about that substitution call all game long, so they want to make sure it's not even close. Because the last one did go to the Cyclops, so if they're going one side, here's Bergen with the outside shot. Sorry, wide shot. Josh Wasson finds John St. John open, and the door opens. Childerhos. Oh, and Lubchuk couldn't hang on long enough. Joe Wasson was giving chase. As there's Goddard down low. Ends up at the restraining line.
Oh.
Lubchuk into the back of Brown. And Wayne
he's going
Paddock
to the box.
Is going to send him.
Gord Brown was indicating for a possession call, but Wayne
2 minutes
Paddock
from behind.
Definitely calling the front, hitting from behind. Lubchuk looks, or Childerhos looks a little disbelievingly at him, but to me, this is the kind of play that you have to call.
Yeah,
I mean, he's a couple of feet away from the boards, pushes him right in the numbers, head first into the boards. Nothing untoward happened here, but you just got to take that kind of play out of the game. Childerhos still protesting, but and that's something that I was talking to Wayne Paddock yesterday. He did color with me on the game, and we were talking off air, and he was saying that's one of the things that he's seen is some of those going uncalled, and he really wants to take that out.
So it is, I will say, credit to Wayne and to Jeff Dowling, who's really taken on the officials' roles, being in charge of the officials and how that stuff is called. Speaking to the officials, dissecting the game in that way and making sure that as the season progresses and maybe individual battles and things like grudges start creeping into the game, that those types of plays do get taken out some. But Wayne Paddock was the guy that could see the numbers there with Gord Brown, his angle on this side. That's why I think he had just the possession call, and Wayne Paddock came over to make that call. And a nice job to take the leadership on the floor there as an official anyways.
And we've pointed out a few times that we've disagreed with the officials, but I'll tell you, they do a pretty good job overall.
And today especially, our normal guys are out at the OLA clinics. That one, Bergen. Oh, how'd that stay out? Bounces off. Looked like the post, the crossbar, and the floor in behind Brees. And here comes Lupchuk down shorthanded. And that one's in about the 15th row if the screening wasn't there. Not sure if he got the stick check in or not. But
yeah, Nick Crasby must have gotten his stick onto Lupchuk's, because Lupchuk saw his man, knew exactly where he wanted to go with it, and threw it about 10 feet over his head. So you got to give credit to the defender there, Crasby, for hustling back and making that play.
And the big line back on the floor. Garen behind his back looking for McNulty. They've shifted Joel Shepley over there to keep McNulty off the crease so they don't go quick stick, as here's Garen stepping in. Nice. Goes off the back glass and immediately right back to him. They reset the shot clock. It must have hit Jay Priest on the way through.
Yeah, definitely glanced off of Priest, but came directly back to Garen.
Josh Wasson. Again to Wasson at the restraining line. He threads the needle looking for McNulty. That was off a stick in front, deflected it just enough. And that lets Eric Petrie bring it up for the Cyclops. Let's put a bow on the officials here as we back to 5-on-5. As the normal officials for the CLax are out at the OLA clinic. So Gord Brown and Wayne Paddock, they were called into action pretty late after the official schedule was made out too. So let's not forget that. Here's Gamble taking a few whacks just as he hung on. This is Turf Dog's clock, and the 10 second count should be on. And that'll nullify that, as Andy Campbell takes the shot. And Croswell goes down to make the save. Brandon Armstrong over center. Final 90 seconds of the third quarter before we switch sides again and head for home. Pick comes from Adamson, opens up space for Armstrong. That hits off somebody's foot. And I believe it's Childerhos again. Man, rough 8 minutes or so for Childerhos as he's been in the box a couple times and now hit by a shot that takes a bad bounce up into the screening. Dan Keene, look out here, his turnover. Looks like he's got Dylan Goddard on him, though. Nice little stutter step to break stride and almost got around. Goddard spins and then the hopping shot over the top. Croswell makes the save as we're in the final 60 seconds, rather.
And Hesseltine with a nifty little one-handed shovel push of the loose ball as it bounced in front of Croswell. He had no chance to grab it. He just tried to tap it home. Didn't quite work out for him, but a creative play.
Tyler Glebe just grabbed the back of the jersey of the player. That would have been another substitution call offensively. But grabbed the back of his jersey to make sure he stayed there. And Mike Burke, the man back on defense for the Cyclops. That ball took a funny hop as they were looking for the breakaway. And now the Cyclops call their timeout, 27.9 left.
Interesting use, as we saw Durham do that in the first half. At the end of the first quarter, taking their timeout, not saving it. Still the second, I guess in the first half, you know, either way, but here in the second half, a lot of times you will see teams try and save that timeout for the end of the game rather than the end of the quarter, but I guess they feel like, you know, use it now, get themselves set up, and get Jay Priest off to the bench, get that extra attacker out.
Well, and they do it with, not that it's going to make a difference on this play, but the short offensive change too. Mm. So if they get in trouble, their bench is right there.
There's the carpet being laid here in the General Motors Center in time-lapse photography. JBI Sports Network brings you the best of sports on the net. Visit jbisportsnetwork.com. If you want to get your event covered, get in touch. You might get Matt and I to come out and call it for you.
Sweet. Or,
but that's not a, if that's a deal breaker, we don't have to go and do it.
And of course, the Roland Systems Group, all the equipment down there at beck and call of the fingertips of Alex Frazel, provided by the Roland Systems Group. So our thanks to them and JBISportsNetwork.com.
Yeah, Roland provided some really nice equipment.
Commentate your 60th birthday party.
There you go. We'll do our research, some nice color commentary about all your friends. They're going to wait now with 23 seconds left in the quarter. Obviously, Southwest with Priest on the bench will wait until there's about 8 seconds before they start moving towards the net.
Critch has it up top. Childerhos is down low, as is Hesseltine. As is Ryan McGregor, and no surprise there, the outside shot from Dan Keene bounces off the boards and up into the timer's box. And Priest doesn't have time to get on the bench. What a job by Childerhos after a rough quarter, sprinting all the way back. He was halfway in the offensive zone there for the Turf Dogs. Came back, saw what was happening, got the stick check on Wasson. I don't think there was time anyways, but you still got to applaud the effort.
Yeah, no point risking. And it did look like the ball went into the official's box there, but it didn't. It bounced back out straight to Wasson, who was had great presence of mind to be ready to rip that shot. But like you said, Childerhos took the chance away, so it'll still be 10-8 when we go to the fourth quarter for the Durham Turf Dogs.
And we'll do that on the other side of this timeout.
Identified the gap between education and the stressors of the working world. We develop customized programs for each student at an affordable cost. Students can choose from over 30 diploma and certificate programs offered at any of Academy of Learning College's 17 Ontario-based locations. Simply a better way to learn. Learn more at academyoflearning.com. Fire Monitoring of Canada is the leader in the fire alarm monitoring industry, specializing in the early notification of fire alarm signals to the fire department. Our experienced customer service staff will work closely with you to develop the best solution for your specific monitoring needs, and our CFAA certified technicians are qualified to perform your installation quickly and efficiently. Be sure to choose Fire Monitoring of Canada because saving time saves lives. Visit us at fire-monitoring.com.
A five-goal run by Southwest in the second, a five-goal run for Durham spanning two quarters. We end up with a 10-8 score as we head to the final 15 here at the General Motors Center in Oshawa. The Turf Dogs trying to play the ball, and it is Tim Bergen off the faceoff. Miller Rushbridge goes on him. I think he's played a solid defensive game here today. Has Miller Rushbridge gotten the rush a couple times as well, as Cody Adamson chases that down into the corner. John St. John, five on the shot clock, shoots it. It's off the kneecap of Jay Priest, who is now manning the net to our right. And the Southwest Cyclops control the rebound. They'll bear down on Kevin Croswell, who takes up the net to the left of your screen. Brady Hesseltine, his shooting lane was blocked, so he goes up top for Dan Keene. Keene there for Webster, takes a bit off the shot. And it's Croswell with the save.
Hesseltine just kind of takes a poke at that ball as Croswell's trying to pick it up, and Eric Shule lets him know he doesn't appreciate Hesseltine reaching into his goalie's crease. And then Aaron Brown gets the better of a collision with him.
Keen loses Goddard as he goes in untouched, takes the shot. McNulty couldn't catch up to that, and they wanted a too many men called in Southwest, but it's just over and back. As Miller Rushbridge picks it up again. A pick in front, now a roll from Jake Kranz. Collides with Gamble after that shot. Croswell made the save, and it's Hogarth. He gets the rebound. He's got Guerin coming with him. Pete Rennie up the middle. And they all peel out so they can make personnel changes. Over on the bench, the first man off is Josh Wasson. Guerin will stay out. No surprise there. As he passes in for John St. John, and he scores! A sub shot from St. John. Is that his first goal of the season?
We'll take a look, but that is a dandy little maneuver by St. John. I think he has one already. That will be his second of the season.
Even still, low numbers for John St. John. The arrival of Jesse Garrett and McNulty have hurt him, but this is just a nifty play.
That's just a great little move. He comes in, gets the pass with lots of space. As the man comes to him, he just steps back out to create a little bit more space for himself and drops down sub shot, and just a very accurate shot.
And now Durham wins the faceoff. Grasby and Armstrong, a two-on-one. And Grasby was thinking shot all the way. Oh, boy. That's taking the nine-foot rule a little too far. As Childerhouse just ran straight through. Player looking for the loose ball there. Ends up getting picked up by Jesse Guerin. He shoots it into the corner, and now it's controlled by Southwest. Go up for Brady Hesseltine. He gets a step on Wasson. An extra pick there from Berg. That allows Hesseltine to take the shot off the shoulder cap of Croswell. Now the double team on Berg. The ball was long gone, though. Keen had it, headed to the net, and they blew play dead so they could reset the 30. Here's Critch. That shot hits Joe Wasson in the midsection, and he doubles over. And a moving pick against the Turf Dogs, and they don't like that one either.
Wasson looking very uncomfortable after that shot, but he'll stay out, show some toughness as he stays on for his shift.
Shuo immediately on Dan Keene as, I guess, the word's getting out on the 77. Keene for Petrie. Keene is way outside the restraining line. He scored from there in the first. This time he does not. Rebound chance for Hesseltine, though. Croswell's down and looks like hurt in the crease, holding his right knee.
Calling immediately for the trainer. He just waves her in. And we'll see. He's got his helmet off and holding his head in pain. That would be a big blow. John Cheeseborough, the backup goalie, is grabbing his gear and getting ready to come in if he has to. Cheeseborough, an able backup, but you never want to lose a goalie who's playing this well for you. And Croswell having an outstanding game and a nice play there, just showing why he's so effective, makes the initial save. And then the ball bounces out, and he got up and into position while the ball was picked up by the Southwest player, causing him to shoot high because it looked like he was going to have an open net to shoot at. And Croswell just recovered his balance and got into position to make it a more challenging shot. We're going to see the play here. Gamble is pushing Burke into the boards, and he's actually on the floor, as you said already, and waving. Here it is. There's the shot from outside, and this is what I'm talking about, getting up in position to take away the chance for Dylan Webster.
You can see as he goes, your eye on the right leg right here, as it just kind of stays and buckles underneath.
He is up. And it looks like he's planning to stay in the game, wincing a little bit as he steps on that leg. Yeah, he's staying in. Cheeseborough has taken off his helmet. Croswell has put his back on. Thomas Hogarth gives him a fist bump, and we'll be underway. An 11-8 lead for the Durham Turf Dogs. Much of it riding on the shoulders of an excellent performance from Kevin Croswell, so I'm sure everyone's pleased for them that he's able to stay in.
And now the most important shot becomes the next one from the Cyclops, and it comes from Webster, and it's through the five hole. And Croswell goes for a walk with a bit of a limp in his step, but it's 11-9.
12 from 17.
Yeah, it's Miller Rusbridge actually taking that shot, the righty. He just fires that one, and Croswell looked like he didn't even see it. I don't know if it was a matter of not moving for it. He immediately goes over and starts stretching. But you're going to see Rusbridge just pick the ball up off the turf, comes around and shoots through a screen. Yeah, and I think that's more a matter of not seeing that ball because he shot through a couple of Durham defenders.
Big collision and scrum for this faceoff again. We've seen that a few times. It's Cudmore coming away with the loose ball. Being chased at different points by three Southwest players. Tried to get it back for Cody Adamson. And again, Jake Kranz takes advantage of the 9-foot rule as they go into play for this ball. And a huge scrum in over the boards as three players end up down on the carpet and getting the worst of that. Getting up slowly, Travis Burton.
Well, he's only 18. Burton loping up the floor, and the game really getting physical. Not a lot of chippy stuff, just a lot of physicality, really working hard on both sides of the ball.
Here's Burke from the outside. That one up high on Croswell. If you see an injury like that, do you want to shoot it at a specific spot, or do you want to try and get Croswell moving at this point?
Well, I think you want to get him moving, and if it seems to be the knee that was a problem, do you shoot about hip high, see if he can move to get it?
That one off the face mask of Priest. He took one like that in Southwest last week in Paris and caused the stoppage of play. Looks like he's all right here, though.
Andy Campbell with the ball straight into his stick. Didn't know for a half a second he had it, but realized he did, ran up. Now gets it off to Dan Keen.
Backpedaling his way in is Keen, up for Eric Petrie. Petrie shoots around Guerin. Comes back for Keen again. Under 10 to go in the shot clock now as they chase him way outside. A pick from Spanger, the shot there, and he did get Croswell moving to his right, and you could see him get up slowly as Spanger, the loose ball machine, earned him an all-star nod last year. This Critch sub shot picked up by Webster. Again, extended pressure here for the Cyclops. And the shot dropping low for Keen. No one really sure where the ball is. It's caught up in Croswell somewhere.
Croswell and getting up slowly. But after that initial shot, he's making all the saves, but definitely not looking very comfortable as he gets up off the floor. Goes for a little stroll.
Moving very slow. Watching the trainer, and she hasn't looked away from him at all. Kevin Croswell, definitely in discomfort, but as long as he keeps saving those, like you said, if he says he's good, why not? McNulty up top, John St. John. He tries to skip one in now, that gets caught in the throat guard, but still manages to stay in front of Brees. And here's Spanger. That line heads off as Kranz. In transition, Miller Rushbridge winds and shoots. That one gets behind Croswell.
Second in a row for Rushbridge, and that's just a fine shot. The last one he used to screen, this one looking very much like Mike Burke scoring at a dead
12,
run.
17, and captain.
And captain Mike
didn't see his
Burke.
Number, he had the C.
16, Mike Burke is the captain.
I think it's Burke. 16, yeah. Good for you.
There's the pass, just a nice little lob pass by Kranz, and gets it across. Great play, a great shot by Miller Rushbridge, his second goal in a row. It is a one goal game. Durham holding on to the lead. We're gonna have a big scramble in the corner, a scrum. Kranz actually grabbed the back of someone's jersey. They spun around and had some words. Now Pete Rennie tying up with Kranz. Kranz seems to have been in the middle of everything for the last 4 or 5 minutes. And they've grabbed at least one guy, and it looks like probably two, heading off.
And that's really where the physical play picked up. It did start with Jake Kranz. He completely ignored a loose ball about 4 minutes ago. As offsetting roughing minors, it looks like. 4-on-4 is the sign from Gord Brown.
Yeah, so we will go 4-on-4 as they both make their way to the box. 8:50 to go here. And Dylan Goddard will start with the ball up top.
Pete Rennie, another member of those, that transition that former GM Dave Colburn wanted. Oh, what a fake! Is that Guerin again?
That is Jesse Guerin.
Oh,
what a
goodness.
Beautiful play. Great body control. And then the finish.
9:49:43.
There's the initial pass by Bergen. A nice little touch pass by Goddard. And Guerin just dragging his toes so they don't go inside the crease as he tucks it home. And there you see the last love tap with the stick from Jake Kranz is what got that whole thing going at the other end.
Dylan Webster awarded the faceoff here. Didn't necessarily win it. And immediately on him, Joe Wasson looking for over and back. Priest thought there was a delayed penalty coming. There wasn't, but now there is. So he does head off. He was about halfway there anyways. As Critch over to McGregor. McGregor's shot goes off a leg. So they go back for Crick. She's got a ton of room. Should he choose to fire, he goes for Keane, which the past couple games has been a good thought. Burke can't hang on to that after getting drilled into the board. So Critch up to play for it. Back for Keane again. Hogarth gets in the way. And looked like Keane was just going to surrender the power play. But he drags it out here with 12 on the clock. Up for Burke. Falls out of his stick. Keane is still getting worked over on the sideboards. And Keane and Hogarth still tied up.
And Dan Keane, I think, is going to take a penalty here because he had a tight grip on Hogarth's arm as it was tucked. No, they're calling it the other way. My bad. I thought Gord Brown had seen that because Hogarth was roughing him up. He was just trying to get loose half of it, and Keane had his arm clamped down on Hogarth's hand. But instead, it's going to be Joe Wasson on the other side. So
that was the initial penalty from before. So
they're saying the Durham got possession of the ball. I thought we had another penalty coming that would have evened it up.
It was their shot, and I think Croswell made the save on that last attempt there. And
Matt Giles is calling over the officials, trying to talk to Wayne Paddock.
Yeah, he just wanted an explanation, it looked like, on the penalty. And he does get that from the crew chief and says, okay, just wanted to check.
Yeah, Durham had four players hitting out on the floor. They had to pull one back, so Aaron Brown goes back to the bench.
Well, the initial offsetting ones here, they do have to serve that, and it does go on the board. So we're 4-on-3 and penalty shot territory for the Durham Turf Dogs now. Should they take another penalty here? Scott Gamble out there on Childerhose. And Burke, bouncer through the legs of Croswell, and so much for the penalty shot. Thought if you're on the bench as the Cyclops, but they'll take it as it's 12-11.
16, 79, 25.
So difficult for the defenders out there. You've got Brandon Armstrong, Thomas Hogarth, and Scott Gamble out trying to defend against that 4-on-3, and they actually moved fairly well, but it's just so difficult when there's that much space. You get Critch making a simple little pass to Mike Burke, a couple of teammates on the Guelph Griffins who won their second straight Kufla championship this year. And that is just a perfect shot, finding the spot between the stick and the foot of Kevin Croswell. I don't think that's got anything to do with Croswell being banged up. That's just a perfect spot.
Cudmore has won it rugby style. He's won it clean. And now how about a soccer kick all the way down past the restraining line to win a faceoff back for Gamble. Brown has it here. His foot goes over and back. So that is the call as Rushbridge picks it up. Being chased by Adamson. Adamson gets the stick check there, so Jesse Guerin is able to corral it. And now the offsetting Miners back on the floor, so we're going to play 5-on-5 here for a bit as John St. John takes that shot, and it's up into the crowd, 12-11. Officials timeout. Did we forget to take it?
It hasn't been taken yet. It's just 6:43 to go, so this is the time it should be taken. And I'll tell you one, we were talking a little earlier about how the scoring has come down. Reminder to let us know who you think should be the three stars of the game at JBI Video is the Twitter account number. And let us know who you think it should be. Certainly some good candidates. But one thing that I've really noticed, and you see Matt Giles already adjusting, the coach is getting so good at getting the players they want out on the floor. You'll see the defense, primarily defensive guys playing most of their defense, primary offensive guys playing most of their offense, which is not that easy to do with the league rules the way they are, encouraging two-way play. And the key, one of them, I think, is deciding who are the guys you're okay going both ways. You see, like Durham, for example, is fine having Jesse Guerin go back and play defense because he's so responsible. They'll have a Thomas Hogarth go up and play some offensive shifts because he can do good things with and without the ball. Southwest has their guys. All the teams have guys they're comfortable with. You can't get everybody on and off. You've got to pick your poison and decide who you want out there. And the coach is getting so good at it.
Remember year one, teams tried that, and they just got blown out of the water.
Yeah.
Just because that's the way the rules are structured. Credit to Commissioner Jim Veltman, as he was the guy that really instituted those rules and thought them up, and they work. Here goes Priest jogging to the bench as they try and surprise here with the extra attacker. Looking for the game tire. Critch, it's through the wickets. Croswell drops to his knees and starts shedding the gear as he can't believe that one happened from that far out.
Well, and the extra man was Jordan Critch coming
up. 25-16.
The sneaky 6-on-5 as Mike Burke gets the ball over to Critch and he buries it. Jay Priest sprinting to the bench to allow that to work. And Burke, we're going to see, just makes the little pass off, and then he heads back. Nice awareness, Mike Burke. That's a captain making the pass, and then knowing that Critch had a shot, running straight to the bench to make sure that Priest could get out if the shot was stopped.
You think they might have talked about that at the official timeout?
They may have. Looked like they were ready to go with it. We're tied up 12 with just over 6 minutes left to go here.
Here's Luke Chuck pulling it out. That's the thing with that side of the floor. When they traded away Shane Scott, we all kind of went, they trade away Shane Scott. Then we watch the chemistry that Mike Burke and Dan Kuhn have on that side. You go, okay, I guess that makes sense now.
And working with Jordan Critch as well, who's such a great setup man.
Here's a bit of a half-hearted shot from Dan Kuhn. Spanger, he takes the loose ball and walks in, gets another shot there. Of course, Spanger was in that Kufla tournament with the Western Mustangs under the tutelage of Jeremy Talibi with the Western program. As Kuhn from the outside. Back for Spanger again. They wait to get their correct change on. Childerhouse. Childerhouse from up top. That one bounces right in front of Croswell. Gonna say off his toe, it looks like. So it comes back for Petrie. Childerhouse again. Adamson on him. Eric Petrie. Spanger in the corner. Outside the restraining line. Petrie now in the middle. Kuhn spins and fires. And again, through the five hole of Croswell, they've figured something out.
77, 32, 13.
Nice movement by the Cyclops. And they tuck it home. Kuhn with the big goal to give them the lead. It's just a nifty little spin and sub shot by Kuhn. With a man on him, it's not even a sub shot, it's kind of a three quarters angle as he just finds a hole. And Kevin Croswell, who was playing very well earlier, really just hasn't looked the same since he went down with that sore knee. You're not sure how a knee's going to affect a goal, how much he's hurt, whether it's a factor, whether it's preying on his mind, or whether it's just coincidence that Southwest is connecting, but definitely has looked like a difference.
Yeah, and he's been disgusted with himself too. So we've seen the walk, we've seen shedding the gear like he did that time, and that one skips off the carpet, it hits Croswell on the way to the netting. So four and a half to play. There's another one from outside. Brady Heseltine, they've figured this out. Have the Cyclops outside shots down low on Kevin Croswell here late in the fourth.
14, 79, 98.
Great shot there by Brady Heseltine. As he gets involved, I believe that will be his first point of the day.
And I think first point of the career of Andy Campbell, as he didn't play last week.
That's right,
Paris.
It is his first game. So now Durham, who's had the lead for most of the second half, suddenly find themselves down a couple of goals and needing to turn things around with the final 4 minutes to go.
McNulty tried the swim move and fell. Nedelko on him. So they go far side. Tim Bergen again. Up for Garrett. Bergen and Garrett. There's a tie up in front of that battle. As the shot comes through from Burton, Priest makes the save. Burton and McNulty in behind Priest. They're going to jaw as the ball comes up over center. And now they're going to let him go here. Jeff McNulty, Travis Burton, they play ring around the rosy and end up in the crease.
McNulty gets thrown to the ground by Burton. Now they're going to get separated, still having some words. But Burton will turn and head to the box.
Jay Priest was in the ear hole of Dylan Lord all last week. He gives it to McNulty now as McNulty gets up and goes to the box.
Here you can see the play starting. Oh, this is the goal at the other end by Heseltine, just above the left knee, under the hand. Such a tough spot when you can get it sharply on. And here they are off to the right there. The camera's just going to creep back over and catch some of this. Just after McNulty had thrown down into the grease. So basically, since you didn't get to see it, Burton grabbed him by the jersey and spun him as he went down. And there's right in front of us, Tucker, the mascot for the Turf Dogs, is giving it to Travis Burton. Burton having a bit of a chat with him. And
Burton
points to the scoreboard. Nice. We're up 14-12, buddy, and has a little smile.
Tucker Turf Dog's been my favorite mascot since his inception last year. And doing his best Green Man impersonation. 2 minutes on the board for the Turf Dogs. Did McNulty get an extra deuce here?
No, it's Burton, taking
the extra deuce. As he gets a four on his side, they just hadn't finished putting them up. So 3:46 to go. The final minute and 46 seconds will be Turf Dog power play. So the Cyclops might want to do something here, 4-on-4. Petrie gives for Keane, and he gets bumped over and back. Cyclops are closest. Garen tracks down the ball. No restart, though. And now they do. They get room. And
heads up play by Jesse Garen to see that if he could get there, he had a chance to break in, but then to slow it down when it wasn't there.
Fake move there. Coming from Bergen, does take the backhand shot.
That's a tough shot with your hands, taking it cross-handed backhand with your hands all the way down on the shaft to get some accuracy. And we saw that one go wide and up into the mesh.
Keen outside for Critch. Now back for Dan Keen again. Pick in front of him. That was Burke on St. John. Now Burke moving on Pete Rennie. And then Rennie drills Burke into the leg of Croswell. And they'll just let that one subside, and Croswell's slow to get up again. Travis Burton, you can hear him from the penalty box in the ear of the official.
Well, the Southwest bench wondering how there's no penalty on Rennie.
Yeah, myself
checking right into the crease.
After the whistle had gone, Goddard and Grasby play catch. Goddard forced to take the long route around by Jake Kranz. Nice slide by Spangler. The pick coming in on Kranz. Goddard gets the pass away to Grasby. The defense starting to tighten up here for the Cyclops. What a job by Jake Kranz and Matt Spangler on this side of the floor. It's been the dangerous side for the Turf Dogs all day long. 30 seconds away from McNulty returning to the floor, and a power play for the Turf Dogs. As the ball to the far side. Trying the little dump pass there was Jordan Critch, who was looking for Heseltine. Heseltine, they must teach that one-step shot in Brampton, because Keane does it, as does Burke, and now Brady Heseltine.
And Heseltine just a couple inches away from getting that in the exact same spot where he scored a goal just a few moments ago.
McGregor looking for the stick check on Brown, and just as the Turf Dogs go to the penalty, he ends up getting it into the kidney pads, so a slashing call against McGregor. 1:45 in the game. McGregor pleading his case here. Travis Burton doing the same, but he's gonna go.
Yeah, we can hear McGregor from all the way up here yelling what when he saw the call being made.
Not sure if you can hear the penalty box mic at home.
Hopefully
we hope you cannot. If you did, we apologize for the enthusiasm down there as Garen and Bergen will start the 5-on-3 power play. A save from Priest and a rebound by Alex Lubchuk. Remember, Southwest used their timeout as a delayed penalty is coming to Durham here. And it'll be an off-ball slash again. It'll still be a power play, though. They'll play four on three in favor of the Turf Dogs, but Southwest will get the ball, and like I said, they will. Well, that'll take Wasson off the floor now.
That's a tough one.
Oh,
he
boy.
Is such one of their really creative offensive players, and he slowly makes his way over to the penalty box. Not too happy, but they were just trying everything they could to get the ball loose away from the Cyclops. And got a little overzealous with the slash from Wasson.
Comes for Critch.
Moving pick.
What the fuck are you calling?
Critch went back to plead his case. Jake Kranz with his head down ran back the length of the floor. What a great defensive game Jake Kranz has had. Over for Bergen, back for Guerin. That's off a couple sticks in front. Is that Kranz again? And afterwards takes Guerin out of the play. Trying to go over the top. Guerin gets a little bit of face mask. They let that one go, 2-on-1. Cyclops content to pull out with 44 on the game clock. Leading by 2, Matt Spanger. He's gonna draw the triple team now, gets away from them again, and again pulls out. And the bench of the Cyclops appreciating that. As now Croswell comes out to play on Spanger in 25 seconds. It is picked up, not using the timeout yet on the Durham Turfdogs. As Guerin has it. Goddard with the pick in front. That one doesn't hit anything, goes sky high, and here's Eric Petrie gonna send it the length of the floor, has a look at the clock. It's gonna be down to 7 seconds as Croswell lifts it up, it hits off the scoreboard. And the Cyclops can kill the final 5 seconds. And Jake Kranz, rightfully so I think, controls the ball. Goes over, he's the first man to congratulate Jay Priest on the 14-12 victory and the first place seeding, at least for the time being, for the Southwest Cyclops.
And that's the third game of the season where we've had 14 goals. Nobody able to crack the 14 mark, but they do equal at Southwest against Durham. The Southwest Cyclops in first place, and we expected a tremendous game here today, a real battle between these two teams, and we got it. Our third star of the game, Miller Rusbridge. That should be R-U-S-S Bridge, but it's close. And or just RUS Bridge, but he is our third star. I don't think you'll mind too much about the spelling with the third star honors. He gets a couple of really nice goals, a good two-way effort for him.
We always like to give nods to guys who step up near the end of the game when their team needs the most. That's why Rusbridge is on this list. We talk about the guys that they don't mind playing offense because they're defensive-minded. He's one of those guys for the Southwest Cyclops, dominant on both sides of the floor.
Our second star today from the Durham Turfdogs with 2 goals and 4 assists is Jesse Guerin. And again, a strong two-way game, a lot of offensive contribution from Guerin, smart play all over the floor. And he gets our second star nod, the first star of the game. Again, playing well all over the floor, primarily in the offensive zone with 2 goals and 5 assists is Mike Burke. But he did get so many things that we saw him do well out on that floor to get that that honor.
And 2 goals, 5 assists, like you said, 7 points on the afternoon. How about the assist he made on the goalie outplay? As he made the assist, the captain, the top point getter in the league, and one of the guys that's up there, the leader on this club, he's the guy that puts his head down and books it to the bench, knowing the goaltender's not there. So that's why Mike Burke is our first star of the game. 2 games on the docket next week, and we will have them for you as we continue our Canadian Lacrosse League coverage. Myself and Wayne Paddock will call the game on Saturday evening, an 8 p.m. start out in Paris, Ontario. The Oswegan Demons, the Southwest Cyclops. Southwest will turn it around quick and head to Niagara, and you and I will be back in Niagara, the Meridian Center, to call the Southwest Cyclops, the Niagara Lock Monsters. A huge weekend for the first place Southwest Cyclops. Our director today has been Alexander Frazau, our producer Gary Morrison. On behalf of them and our entire JVI Sports Network crew and everyone involved with the Canadian Lacrosse League, including my partner Stephen Stamp, my name is Matthew Carrick. We thank you for tuning in. We will talk to you on Saturday.